Hello, Keen here for the third and final time this semester. In this last rotation of woodwind class, I'll be discussing the oboe's assembly process and the embouchure. The oboe is rather similar to the flute in terms of there being three main sections. Starting from the bottom, there is a bell, lower joint, upper joint, and finally, a reed. Let's start with the bell. The only thing to note here is the bell key. It is a bridge key, and you need to be wary about it, like all other bridge keys. It attaches to the corked end of the lower joint. The lower joint is the longer and larger of the two body pieces. Notice that the lower joint has an adjacent bridge key to align with the bell. I will now demonstrate attaching the bell to the lower joint. Moving on to the upper joint, there are two small bridge keys here as well. Though holding these keys down is not paramount, it is still good practice to press them down when attaching the upper joint to the lower joint. Like the bottom half, there are also adjacent pads for the bridge keys to align with. Watch closely. Finally comes the reed.
Bruh.
Oh hell no!
With the oboe reed, you have to soak it longer compared to a clarinet reed. It is a double reed, meaning it's two pieces of cane tied together rather than just one single piece of cane. To soak, Mr. Lefevre recommends a small pill bottle or a shot glass filled with water, as water soaks better than saliva and is less acidic. Once the double reed is soaked, slide the corked end into the reed well at the top of the upper joint. It should insert practically all the way in, and you can adjust its position based off your comfortability, though it should be relatively lined up with the octave keys on the back side of the instrument. With that, the assembly process is complete. Onto the embouchure now.
Hold up! Wait a minute!
お前はもう死んでいる。
何？
The oboe embouchure is fairly simple. According to Mr. Lefevre, the embouchure is a combination of three things: a whistle shape in the mouth, a rolling in the lips, and a squeezing of the corners inward and forward. Let's go through what that all means. A whistle shape of the mouth means you form your lips as if you were going to whistle, even if you can't, like me. Next, from that whistle position, roll the lips inwards. Finally, bring the corners of your mouth close together and forward. These three ideas should create a tight pressure that allows us to make a sound on the reed. When you put the reed in your mouth, only a fraction of it should be in. No more than 1 or 1.5 centimeters should be in your mouth. Too much and you'll be a half step too sharp, and too little, the reed will fall out your mouth or you'll be too flat. As mentioned, the pitch will vary with how much is in your mouth, but a beginner should be able to produce from around an A5 to a C6. There isn't much else to say but to experiment around with the A and reed placement on your own. Otherwise, that is all for this final video. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.